Hi, this is Kalpana, Singhal, founder and CEO of CXO TV from Techplus Media Group, welcoming you all to this conversation on data as the currency for financial organizations to accelerate digital transformation. So what is this all about? We already understand that some of the most critical challenges that hinder the digital transformation goals of financial organizations are centered around efficiency and accessibility of data across various functions. Financial organizations are exploring quick ways to keep their business and innovation going by adopting next generation technologies to propel their growth post-pandemic. But getting there is not that easy. It can take time and cause business disruption. This Fireside Chat will discuss about how to establish an enterprise data management layer to accelerate digital transformation. In order to take this discussion forward, we have with us esteemed panelists. Let me introduce the two of them without further ado. We have with us Mr. Padmabhushan Bahadure, who is the Chief Technology Officer at IDBI Bank. And he is joined by Mr. Amol Diwanji, who is the Head System Engineering, Veeam Software, India and SAARC. So I am extending a warm welcome to the two of you. Welcome Amol and welcome Padmabhushan.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for joining us, and it must be your busy schedule, and we hope to have a very fruitful discussion here. So let me jump right into the first question, which will open with a sense of getting a context. Like Padmabhushan, I'm directing the first question to you. So you have been leading technology initiatives at IDBI Bank for a long time. So what are the three things which excites you about your role across the organization? If you can elaborate, please.
Okay. So see, when I joined IDBI Bank, okay, it was during the pre-COVID era. Okay. And then there were a lot of, roadmaps and visions to be, fulfilled or achieved. That was the initial plan. But then come 2020 and everything has changed. Okay, so now in a nutshell, okay, if I say the responsibility of IT within the bank, okay, is to be available 24/7 to do business and become an enabler of the business. So there is no question of any systemic challenges or upgrades happening or things will take longer time. So now the people both in the bank as well as the customers are expecting banking to be as seamless and as easy to use. Just like the Amazons and Flipkarts of the world, okay. So it should be seamless and give them some, if not say delight, but at least easy to use. So that is the vision, and that is the goalpost towards which we as a bank, and including my role, we are working towards that. Lot many initiatives we have started. Some of them we already fulfilled. Some of them we are in the process of completing those journeys. But yes, it's a very interesting, road ahead for both personally, me as the CTO of IDBI Bank, as well as the bank itself. Okay. Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah. So, Padmabhushan, you just stated your role and what you're currently been doing. So, could you lead us on to some of the digital transformation initiatives which has actually brought in cultural and operational shifts within your organization?
Yeah, so yes, there are quite a few. I would just give you a glimpse of the most recent initiatives. Okay, and last year during our foundation day, that is October 1st, is the on that day we had launched two digital initiatives for both customer acquisition as well as customer service. One of them was a video-based account opening, that is through video KYC, and it was inaugurated by our MD sir also as well, and it has been running fine so far. And I would take this opportunity to say that we are one of the banks who has this video-based account opening solution in our own IT infrastructure. There are many other banks, okay, who have it on, say, other infras like cloud or colos, okay, which are causing them one or the other issues and compliance and things like that. So we are one of those banks. Second one we had launched on the same day was about, say, in the direction of customer service. Because right now there is no clarity on the acquisition part. So we had done it on the customer service through WhatsApp. WhatsApp being the de facto channel of communication these days. So as IDBI Bank, we also have our channel opened on WhatsApp for all the customer say service queries, complaints, okay, some information customer wants. So these two initiatives we launched on October 1st last year. And during 2021, we had say many other initiatives on digital front. Some of them which we started, some of them we fulfilled, something like our digital account opening, upgradation of our say IT infrastructure to handle say the growing business volumes, and also on the say I would say on the recent buzzword, I would not say recent, but the past 4 or 5 years on the API infrastructure. So there also we have launched it and we are ready. So we are in discussions with various say startups and fintechs or various say business avenues, both in the area of service as well as acquisition or say any kind of integration. So these are say I would say the topmost say initiatives that we launched or will be launching soon in the digital space, notwithstanding the other things that we are doing routinely in terms of our IT infra. So time and again we are regularly upgrading, enhancing, or I would say re-engineering our IT infra, because as I said, times have changed and hence expectations have actually grown exponentially. So that's the reason we need to be ahead in the curve, okay? And we are working towards that.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for highlighting those great initiatives. So Padmabhushan, how do you see data as an accelerator for the digital transformation initiatives of the enterprises?
See, data plays a very important role in any initiative. I'll just give say customer acquisition, which I was talking about, video KYC. Okay. Now, assuming that customer is a new to the bank customer, okay, and we get certain information from various other, say, like bureaus, analysts, social media, okay, that information helps us a lot to verify the customer. Okay, maybe for CASA as well as for the loan side. So that is on the say the data from the customer side. Now within the bank, okay, if I want to or if the bank wants to apprise certain proposals, certain credit proposals, or take certain decisions on say classification of accounts, okay, for NPA or special mentions, okay, or red flag accounts, or they want to provide say cross sell or upsell opportunities to the customer, data becomes the key. So we, because all the various systems in the bank needs to be integrated or having a data exchange mechanism, okay, so that all this information is available to the sales rep, to the service representatives, to the say field officers, to the management, to take right information or say right decision at the right time. For that, as within the bank, we have implemented a enterprise-wide data warehouse, okay, coupled with our analytics solution, which gives this information almost on a real-time basis to our say various stakeholders, okay. Because without this information, just having the systems on the digital avenues, the ones, even those which I mentioned, like video KYC or the WhatsApp, if I don't have this information, I will not be able to service the customer in the true sense, okay, because always it will be lagging. So that is one part where we have, say, data exchange and integration of data within all the systems, where data plays a very important role. Be it, say, the data in the form of, say, summarized data, or be it in the form of, say, individual customer what they call the segment of one kind of thing, data that we have in the bank. We are also working on another part of, say, I would call it not a data warehouse, but kind of a data lake, which the bank is currently doing its due diligence, both on the data warehouse part, as well as what we are thinking that we need to create one service data lake kind of stuff. So the customers who are contacting or reaching out to the bank from various, say, channels, be it, say, WhatsApp or, say, telephone, internet, through the mobile complaints or through emails. Okay. So all this data should be available to the person who is servicing that customer, so that he knows who the customer is, he can identify the customer, what has been his pattern in terms of, say, his usage or activities in the banking, and plus what are there any repetitive, say, pattern to his problems, issues or requests. Okay? So we are working on this part. And here we are also exploring how we can use the new age technologies like voice or, say, AIs or, say, the MLs of the world. So we're working on that. So, but again, to summarize everything, all these, say, services or all these platforms that the, say, IDBI or other banks who are trying to, say, build, data is a very key role. So availability of the right data, the right, is the key. Otherwise, all the systems are just, say, IT systems. Without any data, it would not make any sense. Okay. So data is the key, I think. So the it's like that, I would say, salt in your food. Okay. Without that, it's meaningless, right? You can't even eat it.
Absolutely right. Companies of all types are investing heavily in tools and technologies to help them understand their customers more deeply and to gain the advantages of superior customer experience. Yeah, absolutely agree with you. Want to understand, like, how does your data strategy fits into your AI vision and value potential?
So, as I was explaining, right, so we have a data warehouse, we are working towards a service data lake. We have a few, strategies and visions towards having conversational type of banking, towards having AI-enabled models in our analytics. Few of them we already have. So, one of the systems that I would like to highlight here is the bank has a, say, an enterprise-wide, fraud risk management system. Okay, so over there we are using AI and ML models, okay, to check the velocity of the fraud, to check that on a real-time basis, okay, and take the corrective action. Maybe it is corrective action depending on the type of transactions. Okay, those corrective actions are taken on a real-time basis or on a, say, after the transaction has happened, because there are various scenarios. Okay? So here we are using AI ML, even in our analytics, where those information is given to our business heads or to our field force. Okay, there we are able to predict the type of customers that we will be targeting, or the type of growth we have, or the usage of, say, what kind of various services or products the customer may ask. Okay. So these kind of, say, artificial intelligence models, okay, are being developed by our statisticians and data scientists who are currently in the bank. So yes, both of them, say, the data strategy as well as the, say, the strategy for the newest technologies, be it AI or ML or conversational banking, okay, have to go hand in hand. And recently we have also appointed one, our chief data officer. Okay, so who looks after all the, say, data governance, data quality management, and the implementation of the various, say, data models in the bank. So yes, I would say both go hand in hand. And as I said, there are a few which we have already done, and we have embarked on the journey to implement the rest of the initiatives, with data being the fulcrum of everything.
Yeah, absolutely. So great insights here, Padma. You spoke about that, how you're using data lakes and getting those insights which are much required to understand your customers, which I think is fairly sort of a sensible approach. And at this point of time, inviting Amol Diwanji to jump into the conversation. So Amol, welcome once again, and thank you for joining us. So Amol, inviting your views here about what are the three major changes you have seen in the way organizations look at data and democratization of data.
So if you really see in last couple of years, security has become paramount, right? And possibly emerged as one of the top concern for any IT leader. And specifically in financial services, you would see that there is a pretty mature practice around security, and you would see very mature implementation of SOC, with all the bells and whistles, especially on the access side of things, right? And you would see things like EDR, NDR, XDR, advanced firewalling. You would see things like WAF, right? So everything to do with access side is really taken care of, but still bad actors manage to creep in, right? And that's why we're seeing large organization, especially financial services, keen to look at backup as a last line of defense from ransomware attacks. So basically what they really want to do is create immutable copies for the business to be restored from. Now, here is where the concept of double play or triple play comes into picture. Now, what I mean by double play or triple play is simply creation of multiple immutable copies, or what we call as pristine copies, which are free from any sort of ransomware or malware. Now, typically you could create one copy on-prem, second copy could be on a cloud, or it could be on your DR site. A third copy could be created on, say, for example, a tape device or an object store on-prem, right? So you typically create at least 2 to 3 immutable copies for you as a last line of defense. So that's number one trend which we are seeing. The number two thing which we are seeing is, there's been an upsurge in terms of SaaS services consumption. And you would see Microsoft O365 as a number one SaaS service today, right? So be it a small organization or a big organization, right? O365 is used by everyone. And earlier there was a common misconception that since this entire collaboration suite is offered as a SaaS service by Microsoft, they would take care of the data as well. Well, guess what? It's not true. Right, what Microsoft offers you and gives you an option is really to do things like your data retention. They could do archival, they could put a legal hold on certain data, but what they definitely not do is back up your data. The data is your responsibility, right? So this is where we are seeing organizations increasingly creating a data protection strategy for SaaS services like O365. The other service where we see this being happening is Salesforce, for example, because that's also a key enabler for digital digital initiatives in financial services and banks, right? So it's extremely important to back up that data as well. So that's number two. Number three thing which we are seeing is around monitoring and analytics, where customers are typically looking at resolving common problems proactively before they become an operational nightmare, or things like creation of alarms for detecting certain anomalous activity which is going on in the infrastructure to basically tell you that whether there is a ransomware attack or not. And also around reporting whether you are complying with certain SLAs and the other things which management may want to look at, right? So that's number three.
Yeah. Thank you. Absolutely. Great insights, Amol. You have shared your observations in a great way about the security aspect of it, the backup aspect, and definitely. So let me bring in Padmabhushan. So Padmabhushan, what is your view? Like, what are the major challenges financial organizations face around efficiency and accessibility of data across various functions?
Okay, so say within the financial organization, I'll talk about say public or say like us, like IDBI, quasi public sector organizations. Data is created by so many different say stakeholders, and even as we speak today, there is quite an amount of data which is still left to be digitized. Okay. I'm just addressing the business part of the data. So that data, bringing it to the digital platforms in itself is a challenge, and quite many times it happens that just for the want of some statutory or legal needs, that data cannot flow through the system. First, it has to go through physical desks and then it can be put it back into the system. Now, this creates two problems. One is we can't use that data efficiently. And second, the most important part is we cannot derive intelligence from that data because it is not created by the system. It is just kept as records. So that's a major challenge. While we are trying to automate, but still there is quite an amount of data, which is still left to be digitized. That is one. This is one of the challenges what we are facing. So herein we would be like our say the bank and the banking consortium is also in discussion with the regulators and say the statutory authorities. How they can say reduce and automate this kind of systems. That is one. Second is on the technical aspect of data. In this sense, we get various logs from various systems. We get data from what Amol is mentioning, from the SAARC, from the NOC, or from the monitoring operation center. So all this data, there needs to be a clear case of correlation. Now, if say, I'll just take an example. If say today my SOC or NOC gives me certain data, which say this particular IP address or this particular say server is having say some kind of a breach or maybe it is trying to access something. See, until unless we have some context to it, and here comes the correlation saying that, yes, this particular IP address or this particular server belongs to this application, and that application as per the bank's criticality matrix is a critical application or an internal application or an internet facing application, then this correlation makes sense and accordingly necessary actions can be taken. There are systems in our bank as well as other banks, there are systems which do this correlation, but still there is huge scope of improvement in that, it becomes easier for the technology operations team to take necessary actions, be it from security perspective, be it from network perspective, be it from the IT infrastructure in terms of capacity, or the application architecture perspective. So this correlation is really important from the technical aspect of the data. The third and most important part in terms of challenge that we are really facing is, as I mentioned earlier, we have an enterprise data warehouse. We have a very good amount of adoption also in that. But still, there is quite an amount of ground to be covered in terms of creating that enterprise data warehouse in its true sense as a single source of truth, because that is required. Otherwise, we extract data which is submitted to, say, the regulators, to the business heads, to the, to the board of directors, and there can't be different versions of the same data. So a single source of truth is really required. See, here one needs to understand is single source of truth does not necessarily mean that it has to be centralized. It can be federated also, but it has to be a single source of truth. So that is one part on the third important part on the challenge faced in the data. Fourth is, like people are saying on the integrations of the various systems using APIs on the technical part. See, there also has to be a clear-cut strategy on how the data integrations happen and how that data governance is taken care of within the perspective of say data quality, data correctness, then data retention, and then data cleansing. All those things has to be there needs to be a data strategy, which definitely the chief data officer or somebody in the bank holding that portfolio should drive. So these are the four things. If we are able to address to a certain extent these four areas, I think so we will really be making in its true sense the progress that is expected from a digital transformation. Otherwise, digital transformation really means, say, without these elements into taken into consideration, it is just digitization, okay, of systems, and with really no real intelligence or the outcome expected from these systems.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. So how are you addressing these data challenges inside your organization, and how does your FITS architect an intelligent data and AI platform?
So see, as I was saying, say, out of these four challenges, okay, most of them, okay, most of these challenges, except for the statutory and legal aspect, okay, which is not in our control. This is not in IDBI's control. It is basically if the relevant bodies or the organizations like statutory and legal, if they are able to change their processes and willing to accept data that is kept on records using systems, then we already have the system to do it. But just because the recipient or those authorities are not accepting in that particular, say, format or type or the, say, document, then hence we have to abide by that. So until they change, we really can't do much on that. While we are in all readiness to do the, say, what you may call automation or the digitization. The other three, say, challenges, okay? I will come first to the technical part. So yes, we have a integrated next generation SOC, okay, which gives us all the correlation, both from, say, application perspective as well as user behavior perspective. So also is there. So we have a recently upgraded our say SOC to be a next generation cyber security operation center using the latest technologies on say user behavior analysis, network anomaly detection using AI, ML, and all those things. Okay. Using some threat intel also, which are received from various parts of the world's C-site and other things. Also, our NOC has been upgraded with recent solutions. Again, here we are. We have the full-fledged correlation on the NOC part. And in addition to that, we also have our, say, the, as I said, data warehouse, okay, which has source and target systems integrated into the data warehouse, where data is say collected from the source systems and then given into the respective formats and say sizes and attributes and fields, all those things to the target system. So that is already there. The only missing piece that today we have is on the service data lake. Okay, so that is something we are creating, which will definitely improve our customer service operations and also help a bank not only to reduce the cost but also to get new customers, because through service also there are opportunities to cross sell and upsell. So that is the service data lake which is currently missing. Apart from that, we really are in a good amount of preparation and readiness to address these challenges.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, thanks so much, you know, sharing the strategy, you know, how you're meeting these challenges. And of course, there are some practical, I would say, like you're telling that how the compliances has to be and how it will be evolving in future. It completely depends on that as well. So, let's take a view from Amol. So, Amol, how do you think businesses can use technology to automate services to help enable workloads and data to be used across multiple infrastructure or environments?
See, today, multi-cloud is a reality. Right. And especially in financial services and banks, I think there has been a proliferation especially around the production platforms. Earlier, you know, you used to have only, from the infrastructure, certain Unix servers running certain mission critical workloads, and you used to have Wintel servers and you used to have certain, virtual servers. Now things have changed. Banks and financial services organizations are increasingly looking at augmenting cloud services. They are also looking at rationalization of their applications, right? And that's where things like breaking the monolith comes into picture. They for want of course, business benefits, you may want to look at application rationalization, looking at certain application from refactoring perspective or rebuilding perspective or rehosting perspective, right? So what is happening is, like I said, a proliferation of production platforms. So you have a lot of platforms now to look at. Now, what becomes critical in such scenarios from operational perspective is that your data stays portable, or your data should be able to migrate from one platform to another, right? So be it from on-prem to cloud, or from one cloud to another cloud, or be it, you know, amongst clusters within Kubernetes distributions, right? So that becomes the key. Now, you know, of course, migration or portability of data is one. The second big challenge is the restoring it on another platform. And that's where we see, you know, a lot of enterprises actually leveraging Veeam's strength, not only to migrate or make the data portable, but also restore it in a matter of few minutes. Answer to question number three. Well, let me start off by telling you that today Veeam's uniquely positioned to basically have or create a single platform to, you know, basically back up all kinds of data. So your data could be residing, like I said earlier, on physical servers. It could be residing on your private clouds powered by VMware, or it could be Red Hat, or it could be Nutanix, or it could be Microsoft, or it could be, you know, residing on certain cloud services, or you could, you know, like AWS or Google or Microsoft, right? Or it could be also be residing on your Kubernetes distributions, like, you know, on cloud you've got distributions like EKS, AKS, GKE, or, you know, on-prem you've got Kubernetes distributions like Tanzu or OpenShift, right? So data could be scattered across all this production platform. So Veeam today, you know, gives you a singular approach to backup all the data across this platform. So that's number one. Secondly, you know, as we discussed earlier, Veeam allows you to make data portable, or, you know, what we call as data fluidity or data mobility across these platforms. It could be hypervisor to hypervisor, it could be from, you know, hypervisor on-prem to cloud, or it could be, you know, within, you know, one Kubernetes distribution to other Kubernetes distribution, right? So that's, you know, number two. The third big thing which, you know, Veeam enables you to do within the same singular platform and also within the same singular licensing framework is ability to replicate real-time your workload, say, for example, running on VMware to your DR site, right? And this could be done real-time or what we call as, you know, close to zero RPO or continuous data protection. So that's another ability which Veeam provides today. Now, like I said earlier, this is within the same singular platform and within the same singular licensing framework, right? So one is the backup functionality. The second is, you know, replication functionality, which can be core to your disaster recovery strategy, right? And to really, you know, provide you proof points around this, or, you know, how do we walk the talk? Let me give you some stats, right? Today, Veeam has got more than 420,000 customers who trust us with these capabilities. Second is, more than half of our revenue today is generated by large enterprises, right? So these are not only capabilities on paper, but we've actually delivered it across the globe to so many large organizations, financial services, and banks alike. Thank you.
Sure. So thank you so much, Amol, for highlighting those advantages and the capabilities of Veeam. So last but not the least, Padmabhushan, how do you see digital transformation efforts of banking organizations to shape up over the next few years, and how organizations can better leverage on their existing data sets?
See, if we talk about, say, digital transformation for the banking sector, so I believe two, three things will be taking shape, okay, and will drive the entire transformation. One, of course, is the, say, new age technologies, like AI, ML. Even say I would go to the extent of saying the AR, VR of the things, okay, so those are pretty nascent, but that will go a long way. Another important pillar of this banking digital transformation is voice. Okay. Voice-based, today as we speak, there are only service aspects of the banking, or to the extent of collections, which are currently enabled or supplemented by the voice technology. Today, really, we can't do any transactions through voice. Okay, something like we say to the Alexa or the Echoes, okay, saying that, okay, I want to pay my bill. Okay, just pay my bill for this month. Okay, so that's something we'll see. We'll see in the next couple of years. Okay, this is the second one. One is the technology. Second is the voice part. Third is on the digital side, okay, as I've been saying today, when we go to a bank for, getting a loan, okay, so, or we get a card from the bank, or maybe a credit card, okay, we are apprised basis our financial, scoring, okay, mostly financial scoring it is used. Tomorrow, I think so, or when I say tomorrow, in the coming years, we may see the scoring done on many factors. Okay, so coupled with your financial scoring, you will see your social behaviors, your behaviors on the professional platforms like LinkedIn and things. Okay, and then your behavior on other digital channels. Okay. To the extent of how many what is your behavior on these OTTs or YouTubes and things like that, okay, which will actually get will be useful in the metrics to score the or appraise the particular customer. Okay, maybe it is not the main factor, but it is definitely will be used when there is something like if you want to reduce the rate of interest, or if you want to give him an extra loan, or if you want to upgrade the card type. So these things definitely will add, because as I said, data will be the key. So what I state in my form 16 and the way I behave on the other platform, there could be a very vast difference, and that could define the reliability or the surety of repayments or his financial behavior. So all these things will actually be added, and you will see in the next 3 to 5 years of time. And as I've been saying throughout this conversation, okay, and that's what the topic for this today's discussion is also. So data will be the key. So not only data that banks generate internally, which they collect from the customers or collect from RBIs or NPCIs or IDRBTs, okay, or IFTAs, okay, but also data supplemented from other platforms where customer is there. So in a nutshell, we'll see definitely a big change, and thanks to the pandemic, that change has been catapulted, okay, by at least, if not less, at least by 5 years. So we would have seen these things maybe somewhere in 2027 or 2028. We will be able to see it somewhere in 2023 or 4.
Yeah, sure. So
pandemic part is the voice enabled transaction. My takeaway from today is your voice enabled transaction. Alexa pay the bill, Siri pay the bill. I think so, Padmabhushan, if you are able to do that, nothing like it.
Yeah, that's quite interesting. Yeah. And that's the next generation of banking, of financial, I would say, sector as a whole. Yeah. And definitely, as you rightly said, that the pandemic has actually put the digital transformation on a fast track. And it's a boon in bane. Yeah. And data will remain the mainstay for customer experience and business expansion efforts of the financial organizations. Indeed, we had a great discussion on how to streamline our data strategy. So that's bringing us to the end of this conversation. Thanks, Padmabhushan, and thanks, Amol, for your deep insights and valuable thoughts. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Amol. Thank you, Kalpana. And pleasure talking to you. Thank you.
For more updates from CXO TV, please like and subscribe to our channel.